In this video, I'll show you how to make a miniature magnet detector with haptic feedback. I needed this video as my other videos are, well, complicated. Also, if I ever forget how to do it, I can look back into this video. What do you do with it? Well, that's for you to figure out. My use is a secret. So first, let me show you the final device. Okay, I understand it's not possible to apprehend its size. Here, it's next to an English penny now. Oh yes, not everyone would know the size of an English penny. How about next to a mouse? I'm just kidding. The only thing I can find that's quite universal is this lighter. Now, the lighter height might differ, but I always found the width to be the same in all the places I have been. As you can see, it has a small motor at one end that would vibrate differently depending on which pole was detected. Apart from power indication, that red LED also indicates initialization. Yes, I'm sure you can make it smaller, but it does have some other tricks up its sleeve. This circuit is designed around a PIC chip. The rest is rather simple. I have two Hall sensors, a mini vibration motor, one LED, one resistor for that LED, and finally a diode to protect from reverse power polarity. The design should be on the screen now. Not much of a circuit, is it? What's needed? Well, obviously you need a PIC chip and a way to program it. I'm using PIC 12F675, but you can use any PIC chip as long as it has two analog inputs and enough memory to hold my compiled code. To program it, at one point I was using this cheap and cheerful PIC programmer. They do their job and that's about it. Now I'm using PIC-IT 3. This is not the latest version, but for my use, this is perfect. Additionally, you need some Vero board and maybe a breadboard to test before you solder. Which reminds me, you need to be able to solder as well. Let's jump into the actual code now. I did write a version on machine language, but that was a nightmare to manage. Finally, I decided to use C instead, a bit easier. For IDE, I'm using MPLAB IDE version 8.92. Once launched, couple of things we need to confirm to set it up with PIC-IT 3. I already have my code loaded. For compiler under build options, I have compiler for PIC-10/12/16 MCUS light mode version 9.83. You can see my other settings on screen. If I remember, I think the compiler was set using Select Language toolset. Ensure correct programmer is selected. In output window, we should see the message PIC-IT 3 connected. Under device, we have the correct PIC-12F675 selected. As my PIC-IT 3 is connected to this universal adapter, and it needs to be powered from PIC-IT 3 itself. Note that it is possible to hook up the PIC chip straight to the PIC-IT 3 and skip the universal adapter. For that, in PIC-IT 3 settings and then in power tab, we need to have power target circuit from PIC-IT 3. I have set it to 5V, and though it ends up sending 4.7V to that circuit, that's well within range for the PIC chip as well. I can safely accept voltage caution that reminds us not to pass 5V to a 3.3V device. Duh! Finally, we can build and program, which means uploading the code to PIC itself. We get another warning. I can go around and fix it, but couldn't be bothered. It works fine. In output, we should see programming verify complete. As the code scrolls very slowly, I'll explain my reasoning for using two sensors. Well, this is what I found from my basic test. Face of the Hall monitor seems to react better than the back. Knowing the working principle, I can understand why that can happen. Thus, having two next to each other but facing the other way means this gadget would have the same detection range regardless which side the magnet is approaching from. Next, I had a situation where I had the magnet at a specific distance away, but the magnet was too powerful and would trigger my sensor. I couldn't change the magnet and didn't want to move my sensor. I guess I could have solved it with a variable resistor, but I wanted it to be smart. So from my code, I detect initial Gauss and set up a dead zone based on that, meaning the magnetic force has to be higher than initial red to be notified. Code is also pretty simple. We initialize all the peak properties and then loop our work, which is detecting magnetic pole every 100 milliseconds. Finally, I'm using the interrupt caused by timer overflow to change the vibration if needed. That's it. I also want to know which polarity. To solve it, I'm using two different pulses on the vibration motor. Just for fun, I'm running the compiled hex code in a simulator, as I don't have a physical oscilloscope right now to visually show you what happens. I'm using two variable resistors to mock our Hall sensors, just as a Hall sensor would behave if a magnet is brought close to it. We can have the same effect with this variable resistor voltage divider. Note, as we change the resistor values, we get a different pulse. This is the pulse our vibration motor would get. I guess that wraps it all for this video. If you have liked this content, please do the usual thing. I would also ask you to subscribe, as during this start, it is vital for a channel growth. Have a safe day. Signing off.